They do. We're trying to clear immigration.
Oh, are you?
Yeah. Although, to be honest,
we're on now.
There's no chair here. Can you move?
I can. Yeah.
Sorry.
It's all right.
It'd be easier than moving the chair around.
Absolutely. I can just sit here like this.
Man, we're ready to go.
We got to get.
Well, I think we're okay. We're going to go ahead and.
So nobody gets thirsty.
Thank you all for being here. We have a vote on now. We will go vote and we will return imminently. Meanwhile, you all stand fast. Okay, I see you back, Bill. And I apologize for this disruption, folks, but we have no choice but to go vote, but we will return.
How are you?
How could I forget you? And isn't the world an interesting place?
You've got to vote. You've got to vote. Sheesh.
Don't say hi to the KU memory.
So, what'd you get here?
Did we get some warning?
Shattered.
It'll even get brittle.
The Subcommittee on Course Intellectual Property of the Internet will come to order. Without objection, the chair is authorized to declare recesses of the subcommittee at any time. We welcome all of our witnesses today. And at the outset, I want to again to reiterate our apology for the delay. The votes take precedent oftentimes, and I'm sorry, appreciate your patience. I'll give my opening statement, then call on Mr. Watt afterwards. This afternoon's hearing is an initial step for the subcommittee's effort to undertake a comprehensive review of our nation's copyright laws. Last month, when Register Pilati testified before this subcommittee, she illustrated the mutual interest of authors and the public, as she accurately and eloquently explained, quote, as the first beneficiaries of the copyright law, they are not a counterweight to the public, but instead are at the very center of the equation. As such, the copyright law must start with the creator as the center of the equation. As Ms. Pilati concluded, a law that does not provide for authors would be illogical, hardly a copyright law at all. Central to any review is identifying what has worked and is working in the law. Our copyright law is well rooted with 200 years of precedent that has produced a level of creativity and innovation that is the envy of the world. Our consumers enjoy an incredible selection of high-quality content that is available on an array of technology platforms. Meanwhile, we continue to lead the world with new ideas and creations. These achievements are stunning and should not, in my opinion, be overlooked. That being said, I commend Chairman Goodlatte and Register Pilati for recognizing the need for a comprehensive review. Piracy is an enormous piracy or threat, in terms of synonymous in my opinion, is an enormous problem that must be addressed. Licensing is a periodic battle which oftentimes leaves consumers with the short end of the stick. We should take the time to consider whether there are other options. Our high-tech innovators, which are also helping to drive creativity, are frustrated by all the above. Our policies should incentivize innovation, not frustrate it. These are some of the many issues I hope we will have an opportunity to review to determine whether or not the law is meeting its constitutionally ordained purpose. I'm interested in hearing how this witness panel of diverse perspectives on copyright law was able to put aside their differences in an effort to work together. Such efforts and others like them should be applauded. This committee has often heard from witnesses who were better at talking at each other rather than with each other. Of course, that does not mean that anyone should retreat from his or her views on any subject. It should come as no surprise that the ranking member, Mr. Watt, and I do not agree on every issue that the full Judiciary Committee considers, but we try to serve the people of our great state. And by the way, I'm pleased to see that one of our witnesses this afternoon is from the University of North Carolina. Efforts in the copyright world to recognize where consensus can and cannot be reached are helpful as we undertake a comprehensive review. I have no doubt that Chairman Goodlatte, I, and other members of the subcommittee will hear from interested creators over the months ahead on how copyright is and is not working for them. The Register has already highlighted some problems with copyright law, especially for the ability of copyright owners to protect their works. The report generated by the Copyright Principles Project and the testimonies submitted today have also highlighted problems that need to be addressed. It seems to me that those who believe everything should be free fundamentally disrespect the creators who have put so much effort into their works and improve our nation's culture as a result. I again want to thank the witnesses for your presence today, your willingness to spend so much time working in a collegial manner with those whose views they may not always embrace or agree with. Their willingness to listen to others in such a manner is one that I urge everyone to follow. I'm now pleased to recognize the distinguished gentleman from North Carolina, the ranking member, Mr. Bell Watt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for convening the hearing. For those of you who showed up today expecting my grandson, Nico, I have to extend my regrets after yesterday's performance went viral on a number of outlets, including Good Morning America this morning and others. He said he was giving me no more exposure without royalties. So he's not here with me today, although he's still in Washington, for those of you who want to sign him up. Anyway, let me be serious. Earlier this week, I attended the We Write the Songs event at the Library of Congress. The auditorium was packed with an audience transfixed on the skillfully crafted lyrics and the astonishing performances, including the electrifying performance that earned a standing ovation from the audience for a young group out of my home state of North Carolina, the Carolina Chocolate Drops. Bearing in mind the chairman's call for a comprehensive review of copyright law in the digital era, I left the event with an even more passionate view that our copyright system must preserve and protect the rights of the creators of the music, books, games, movies, and other forms of intellectual ingenuity that enrich each of us individually and all of us collectively as a nation. I start with this observation because it seems that over the past few years, there has been a shift in public discourse about copyright away from the people who actually devote their talent to create works for the benefit of society and those who invest in them, toward the users of those works and the financial interest of those companies eager to commercially exploit them. That shift has often been accompanied by assertions of lofty principles and constitutional values. But as I have said in the specific context of online theft, free speech does not mean free stuff. And the free flow of information, even through legitimate channels, doesn't mean that information, the substance of what is flowing, should be free. It simply cannot be the case that the digital age turns creators into content servants for the rest of us. That said, I am neither hard-line nor hard-headed about the realities of today's marketplace or the complexity of the task before us. The digital environment is replete with both challenges and opportunities. But currently, uncertainty abounds for all stakeholders. Companies that invest in and develop individual talent must be secure in their expectation that strong copyright exists and that a mechanism to enforce those rights effectively is in place. Consumers deserve clarity about legitimate uses, and internet and tech companies should have clear rules to help them develop sustainable business models that fairly compensate authors. Companies that invest in creative talent may have to adjust their business models to accommodate the digital revolution, and many have. But the digital companies, some of whom have taken to exalting their disruptive power, well, they are not exempt from the need to adjust their practices either. Keeping our focus on creators, while hardly novel or radical, is seemingly controversial in some quarters. Some of that controversy is evident in the Copyright Principles Project report and process that we will hear about today. Some is also evident in the reaction to the report. For example, the op-ed authored by musician David Lowery that was published earlier this week, which I ask unanimous consent to offer for the record. As Chairman Goodlatte has made clear, the committee does not endorse the specific recommendations of the Copyright Principles Project. Still, the project does contain some useful background and insight into how parties with divergent views might be able to engage in a constructive and respectful dialogue. I'm particularly intrigued by the recommendation to strengthen the exclusive right of copyright holders to control communications of their works to the public, which I believe more closely aligns with the principle that aims to preserve and protect the creator's rights. A report from this committee in the 21st Congress observed, quote, "It cannot be for the interest or honor of our country that intellectual labor should be depreciated, and a life devoted to research and laborious study terminate in disappointment and poverty," close quote. As we review copyright law and policy in the digital era, this committee should work to secure the rights of the creators who enhance our lives and grow our economy while balancing the interest of the public. Let me be clear that I believe that the global appetite for intellectual property will benefit best from a robust copyright regime that protects the individual expressive rights of creators and authors. Mr. Chairman, I thank you for the time and I yield back.
I thank the gentleman from North Carolina and other members' opening statements will be made parts of the record if so desired. I stand corrected. Our chairman of the full committee just arrived, the gentleman from Virginia, Mr. Bob Goodlatte.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I apologize for being late getting back.
Mr. Chairman, thank you for holding this hearing. This afternoon, we will hear from several participants in the Copyright Principles Project who collectively have worked or studied copyright issues for decades. They have also traveled here from all over the United States, and I thank them for their willingness to be here today. Copyright is a fundamental economic principle enshrined in our Constitution. It has become a core part of our economy and society in ways the framers of our Constitution could never have imagined. The ways in which creators could express themselves when the Constitution was written were very limited. Photography, musical recordings, film, and software did not arrive for decades, if not centuries, afterwards. Even many of these creations have changed significantly as digital technologies made the creation of content more diversified. Digital technologies have also enabled wider distribution to occur. Local artists can have a global reach. The passion and skills of our nation's creators have enhanced our society and culture. Creators deserve our support and respect. Despite rapidly changing technologies and business models since the enactment of the 1976 Copyright Act, there appears to have been few efforts to bring together parties from different perspectives to discuss how the 1976 Act has worked as technology and business models evolve. There have certainly been short-term events where interested parties spoke for a few minutes each about the latest technology or the latest court decision. What has been lacking is something broader in perspective. What impressed me about the Copyright Principles Project was not its report or even on what issue its participants were able to agree or disagree. In fact, the committee does not endorse the specific recommendations and findings of the report. However, we do want to highlight that its participants with strongly held views on copyright law, many of which were in direct opposition to each other, committed to spending 3 years together in an effort to productively discuss copyright issues. The committee has invited 5 of the participants here today as an example of how people with divergent views on copyright law can productively debate a range of copyright issues. Their written testimony highlights the fact that they are all here this afternoon, certainly not speaking with one voice, but speaking with a recognition that the person next to them at the witness table has just as much right to advocate their position on copyright law as they do. This Judiciary Committee is no stranger to policy issues on which opinions vary widely. This hearing room has and is continuing to debate numerous policy issues in which there are sharp disagreements. There were, of course, sharp disagreements on the 1976 Copyright Act that we use today, and whose hearing record in 1975 in the committee journals is before me. Since announcing my interest in a comprehensive review of copyright law several weeks ago, a variety of interested parties began identifying their specific areas of interest that they wanted to see reviewed. I appreciate their input, and I look forward to working with all interested parties. We should not be in a rush to focus on specific issues without first recognizing the fundamentals of copyright and the social and economic benefits that copyright brings to our economy. It is my intention to conduct this broad overview by hearing from everyone interested in copyright law as we begin by holding hearings on important fundamentals before we begin to look at more specific issues. There are numerous questions that will be raised by interested parties during this review. I have several myself, including how do we measure the success of copyright and what metrics are used? How do we ensure that everyone's voice is heard? How is copyright working for individual artists? How is copyright working for our nation's economy? These are only a few of the issues we will be looking into. This review of copyright law will not be a quick process simply because the issues are so numerous. However, we must undertake this review to ensure that copyright law continues to incentivize creativity and innovation in the digital age. I want to thank all of my witnesses for being here today, and I definitely appreciate the chairman's forbearance in allowing me to give this opening statement, even though I had to dash in to make sure it got done.
You're indeed welcome.
We call all of your attention to this light reading if you're having difficulty sleeping at night here from 1975.
I'll begin by swearing in our witnesses, but prior to introducing them, if you would please rise. Do you swear that the testimony you're about to give is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? So help you God. Let the record reveal that all responded in the affirmative. We have a distinguished panel of witnesses today. Each of the witnesses' written statements will be entered into the record in its entirety. And I ask that each witness, if you can, to summarize your testimony in or about 5 minutes. When your green light turns to amber, that is your signal. When the red light turns red, that is an ultimatum. You won't be penalized, but if you could wrap up shortly after that. I'm now pleased to introduce our witnesses. Our first witness today is Mr. John Baumgarten, former general counsel of the U.S. Copyright Office and retired attorney at Prosker & Rose, LLP. Mr. Baumgarten was appointed as general counsel of the Copyright Office in January of 76 by the Register of Copyrights, Barbara Ringer. He served his term until 1979, being a leading participant in the final formulation of the general revision of the U.S. Copyright Act of 1976. Mr. Baumgarten then joined Prosker Rose as partner in 1980 until 2011 when he retired. Mr. Baumgarten received his JD degree from New York University School of Law and his BA from the City University of New York. Our second witness is Professor Laura Gassaway at the University of North Carolina, from the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. And Mr. Watt and I may be guilty of giving you preferential treatment today, Professor. You're from Glory Land. Professor Gassaway joined the UNC Law faculty in 1985 as director of the Law Library and professor of law. She was director until 2006, when she became associate dean for academic affairs. She also co-chaired. She also co-chaired the Section 108 study group for the U.S. Copyright Office and the Library of Congress from 2005 to 2008. Professor Gassaway received her JD from the University of Houston and her BA from the Texas Woman's University with highest honors. Professor Gavaris, Mr. Daniel Gavaris, Professor of Law and Director of the Intellectual Property Program at Vanderbilt University School of Law. Prior to joining the Vanderbilt faculty in 2008, Mr. Gavaris researched international intellectual property law for 10 years on behalf of the World Trade Organization and the World Intellectual Property Organization. He is currently Editor-in-Chief of the Journal of World Intellectual Property. Professor Gavaris received his doctorate degree from the University of Nantes in France. Our fourth witness today is Professor Pamela Samuelson at the University of California, Berkeley School of Law. Professor Samuelson currently serves as director of the Berkeley Center for Law and Technology and as a Chancellor's Professor of Information Management and Law. She's currently a fellow of the Association for Computing Machinery and also serves on the Advisory Board for Public Knowledge. Professor Samuelson received her JD from Yale School of Law and the BS from the University of Hawaii. The fifth and final witness is Ms. Julie Segal, Assistant General Counsel for Copyrights at Microsoft Corporation. In his position, Mr. Segal leads the company's copyrighted trade secrets groups. Before joining Microsoft, he served as Associate Register for Policy and International Affairs at the U.S. Copyright Office, where he led the division responsible for providing domestic and international oversight policy to both the legislative and executive branches. Mr. Siegel also served as adjunct professor at the George Washington University School of Law. Mr. Siegel received his JD summa cum laude from Catholic University and his AB from the Duke University in Durham. We'll give you special treatment too, Professor. Welcome to you all. And if we will begin with Mr. Bumgarten, and I'll remind you again of the signal on your panel before you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I am pleased to appear here today in my individual capacity in response to invitation from the committee to testify regarding my participation.
Could you pull your mic closer to you so we could?
To testify regarding my participation in the Copyright Principles Project. In addition to having served as general counsel of the Copyright Office, I've acted as counsel to copyright owner plaintiffs in a number of leading cases, which are the subject of considerable contention, as well as in non-litigation matters to major copyright industry entities. In short, I've not been a neutral or even in retirement a dispassionate observer of the great copyright debates. But it may use nor, of course, were or are any of my CPP colleagues, whether the numerous representatives of the Academy or the few from the private sector. We all brought to our deliberations strongly held and frequently contesting views. The CPP report is not a disinterested independent assessment, but it may usefully serve as one example of a collegial and informal discussion of the important issues facing this committee as it again takes up its critically important stewardship of this country's copyright law with the assistance of the forward-looking and expert Register of Copyrights. When viewed from the perspective of today's increasingly polarized copyright debates, the process and report of the CPP was indeed a breath of fresh air. A hallmark was not simply civility, but rather real dialogue among representatives of substantially differing views. By and large, the participants listened to instead of speaking past each other and took the remarks of others genuinely and respectfully into account. As thoroughly documented in my written statement, however, this process did not generate a great deal of substantive agreement. Unfortunately, we referred to agreements and proposals and defined them in such a way that understandably may have caused such confusion. In fact, the report's description of many of those misnamed proposals explicitly recorded a lack of consensus, opposing views, expressed concerns, or in a few cases, the need for considerably more detail, participation, and study before any judgment can be made. This is no surprise to this committee, as our panel was instructed from the very beginning to participate in issue spotting, not to pretend to come up with a legislative package, which of course is not our function. We were also asked to demonstrate how contending parties can agree to disagree in civil fashion. Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, I will not review my own objections and reservations with aspects of the report, principally because for the most part, the report does a fair job of at least summarizing them, as well as all other participants. I probably should have written some of those summaries different, but that was not the point of the exercise. But all of this does not mean that the deliberations and report of the CPP are irrelevant to the program that Chairman Goodlatte has announced, or unsuitable as a beginning to the difficult task of Chairman Coble, Ranking Member Watt, and members of this committee. To the contrary, the report expressed the hope that, quote, recording the nature of our disagreements could advance discourse on copyright issues by others. Although the tenor of the CPP deliberations is a welcome tempering of recent copyright debate, there are other instances described in my prepared testimony where procedural and substantive collegiality prevailed on very complex copyright issues, notwithstanding very intense differences. And at the personal level, if I may add, Mr. Chairman, my friend to my left and I have probably not agreed with each other in 40 years, but we have, over that period, had significant discussions, significant and respectful, productive instances where some agreements we managed to extract. At the risk of introducing a discordant note into this discussion, I will conclude my testimony with an additional point. For the reasons spelled out in my written statement, I think it fair to consider the discussions and report of the CPP as somewhat more attentive to perceived problems caused by copyright to access and related interests of users than to the substantive and enforcement needs of authors and other copyright owners in the 21st century. As this committee goes beyond the CPP report towards the announced comprehensive review, I am confident that it will take forward and expand the CPP's focus of attention to encompass even more comprehensively the needs and concerns of authors and other copyright owners, as well as those of all stakeholders and participants in the world of copyright. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Bumgarten. Professor Gessaway.
Thank you. Chairman Coble and fellow North Carolinian, and Ranking Member Watt, and members of the subcommittee. Thank you so much for inviting me to participate in this distinguished panel. I have worked with these folks for many years, and as Mr. Baumgarten told you, he and I have worked together probably more than 35 years, usually taking opposite positions, but remaining friends all that time. I have participated in a number of groups working on copyright issues over the years, representing the Association of American Universities and the Conference on Fair Use, and as you mentioned, co-chairing the Section 108 study group, and then most recently as a member of the Copyright Principles Project. You also heard that I am both a librarian, a law librarian, and a law professor, and so it is natural that my focus throughout my career has been on libraries, archives, museums, and educational institutions, not only on the use of copyrighted works by these institutions, but also on the creation of these works by faculty and employees. My written statement mentions educational uses, but in my comments today, I'm going to talk just about libraries, archives, and museums. Copyright concerns have been part of these institutions long before the 1976 Act and the advent of photocopying. The 1976 Act does not work so well on a number of fronts, but especially for libraries, archives, and museums, and for their users, visitors, and students. The current Act is bewildering, to say the least, often even to copyright lawyers. I believe there are three potential ways to solve the copyright problems that these institutions face. And when I call them copyright problems, I mean, how do we deal with users and still protect the rights of creators, which so many of you eloquently spoke about? The first would be a total revision of the Copyright Act based on principles. I would hope removing some of the regulations from the statute and putting them into the Code of Federal Regulations, where as a law librarian, I'll tell you they belong, rather than in the statute. And at the same time, taking into account the unique roles that libraries, archives, and museums play in our society. For example, as a matter of principle, recognize the roles of these institutions and allow them to provide access to works. Permit the reproduction of portions of works, even in digital format, in order to encourage research, scholarship, and private study. As a matter of principle, the Act could ensure the ability of these institutions to preserve works digitally so that they are available for future generations. In addition to the Copyright Principles Project, another model of these principles might be the European Treaty proposals that I mentioned in my written statement. A second proposal would be to repeal Section 108 and rely solely on Section 107 fair use. The Copyright Principles Project highlights the difficulties with this approach, which I believe are exacerbated for frontline employees in libraries, archives, and museums. Sometimes I think academic law librarians and academic librarians at large institutions, which have legal counsel to advise them, would like to rely solely on fair use. But I will tell you that public librarians and small colleges, which may not have any legal counsel, much less one that's familiar with copyright, are often faced with a user standing at a desk, kind of ranting and raving and wanting to do something, and they need an immediate answer. If only copyright lawyers can understand and apply the act, something is fundamentally wrong. A third way to solve the problem for libraries, archives, and museums is to enact the recommendations of the Section 108 study group and update them as detailed in my written statement. But there are two other issues that are crucial to these institutions: solving the orphan works problem and finding a way to deal with mass digitization. These are serious issues facing these institutions as well as society. Determining and maintaining the appropriate balance in copyright is not an easy proposition. But as the Copyright Principles Project illustrates, it is possible for people of goodwill to come together, discuss difficult issues, and reach some agreements. But they must keep foremost in their minds what is best for society and not just what is best for their constituencies. Thank you so very much. And best wishes to you as you begin this endeavor. If I can help in any way, I would be delighted to do so. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Gassaway. Professor Gavaris.
Chairman Coble, Ranking Member Watt, members of the subcommittee, thank you for the invitation to appear before you today. I wish to begin by commending this subcommittee for its leadership in tackling this issue of utmost importance and economic significance. It is time, I believe, to embark on the process that will give us what the Register of Copyrights recently referred to as the next great Copyright Act, as was done three times in the past, 1790, 1909, and 1976. So much has happened since 1976 when personal computers, the internet, and the digitization of music and the phenomenon of social media were not yet realities. Copyright should allow professional creators, whom I see as small businesses, to get a fair return on their creative investment when their work is successful in the marketplace. It should also allow many sustainable business models to flourish in producing, exporting, and providing access to U.S. copyrighted material around the world. Copyright should also be balanced. Individual users should have fair access to copyrighted material and be able to take advantage of the almost infinite possibilities that the internet offers. As I explained in my written statement, making copyright work should focus on maximizing authorized uses of copyrighted material, because then everyone wins, instead of focusing solely on minimizing unauthorized uses. I believe that copyright modernization is necessary in part because copyright law is now everyone's business. It was not always so. Before the internet and digital devices became what is now probably the most widely used way of accessing copyrighted material, individual consumers and users had few reasons to think about copyright in their daily lives. Copyright was a set of rights for and negotiated between professionals, such as authors, publishers, record companies, and broadcasters. For them, dealing with complex rules was part of the cost of doing business. Individuals who purchased copies of works in the form of books, tapes, or CDs had ownership rights, in fact, in those copies. As a result, copyright constraints were mostly irrelevant in the daily lives of most Americans. That situation has changed dramatically. Accessing a song online, downloading an e-book, streaming a movie generally requires a license, which may restrict the uses that individuals can make of the material. Technological locks may also be in place. On the flip side, however, technology has made it much easier to copy, modify, and disseminate copies of material, including sometimes material that belongs to others. This points to a need to clarify the language of the statute, but also, and more importantly, the scope of rights, exceptions, and remedies. The international dimension is also relevant. I provide details in my written statement. Let me just say that the international picture is beginning to look like a patchwork of rules. I believe a comprehensive review of the statute should allow a clearer path for U.S. leadership in global copyright discussions. I would also like to say a few words, if I may, about licensing. Both individual and collective licensing have become an important vehicle through which creators and other rights holders monetize their creative work. Let me give a brief example of each. Collectively, many songwriters and publishers authorize performing rights organizations, such as ASCAP or BMI, to license musical works for broadcasting and streaming. Individually, authors and publishers may license, say, a foreign publisher to translate or publish an ebook or a book in another country. Whether the internet will perform adequately in years to come as a viable marketplace for copyrighted material is in large measure a function of whether licensing can work. The statute contains 8 compulsory licenses. Those are usually fixes to temporary problems, but they tend to become permanent. One of those licenses was first established for player pianos. I point out many of the other issues in my written statement. I believe the best way forward is to leave some discretion to a specialized agency, such as the Copyright Office, to decide from time to time whether changes are required to those licenses, whether an existing license is still needed, or even whether a new one should be established. Finally, formalities also need to be modernized. When you buy a car, the fact of the car's existence is not, unless perhaps you're a student of philosophy, one that most people would doubt. Registration may confirm things like the model or place of manufacture. For a copyrighted work, it could be the author, the publisher, or the year of publication. But buying a car requires a determination that the person selling the car has the title to the vehicle. This is where recordation of transfers comes into play. I believe that a heightened recordation requirement would ameliorate a number of issues, including orphan works. In closing, I commend the subcommittee for its leadership for this important endeavor and invite any questions that you may have. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Gervais. Professor Samuelson?
Thank you.
Mike, thank your you. Mic is not activated.
I'm sorry?
A little closer to you, if you will.
Mr. Chairman, members of the subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to come and talk about the Copyright Principles Project. This is a project that I initiated, I convened, and I convened it after having a series of conversations with copyright lawyers, both in practice and in industry, and also with then Register of Copyrights Mary Beth Peters. And all of these people encouraged me to organize a conversation to bring together a group of people who had expertise in different parts of the copyright regime and who could talk together about what is working well with copyright law today and what might need to be updated. So it was an effort to reach out to people of different points of view and to bring together a group of people who would be willing to have a series of conversations over time and see whether, at least on some issues, we could reach consensus. And while I didn't highlight this in my statement, I think it's worth mentioning that some part of the report that we wrote actually discusses parts of copyright law that we think, in fact, are really valuable. I think that all of the members of the Copyright Principles Project really believe that a good copyright law is important to society as well as to creators. But we think, I think, that some changes may be needed, and partly this is because the statute has become extremely lengthy. It's very complicated. I've never been able to read it from start to finish. And it seems to me that if we have a law that applies to pretty much everybody who is both a user and a creator, that the law ought to be somewhat more comprehensible than it is today. And I think Register Pallante, when she appeared before this subcommittee recently, also indicated that comprehensibility was really something to be striven for in whatever comprehensive review might be undertaken. Of course, because the law was drafted largely in the 1960s, not enacted until the 70s, but it was a law that was predated the internet, predated many of the challenges that the courts have been facing in recent years. And it's no surprise that things like the reproduction right, the distribution right, and the public performance right, have been difficult to apply because they were written at a time when the technology was very different. So I think that some fine-tuning of exclusive rights is a very important part of the comprehensive review that that is underway, and I hope that some of the ideas that were in the Principles Project report might at least give rise to some useful conversations about how those rights might be tailored to our current environment, and maybe, in fact, some new right might be needed. So one of the things that the Principles Project talked about was a communication to the public right. This is actually something that's in international treaties. United States doesn't have it. It does seem to me that to be more consistent with the international copyright regime, that it might be beneficial to think about what that right ought to do that would be different from the public performance right. While I could go on many other issues, I did want to raise a couple of things that I think that we, with the Principles Project, were able to accomplish. One was to think forward, in a forward-looking way, about reviving the registration of copyright regime. We think that there's not enough good information out there to facilitate licensing today, and that a better regime, a regime that encourages more registration so that we have more information to facilitate licensing would be desirable, and we think that there are some advances in technology that really can help with that. And finally, I do want to mention that I agree with the Register of Copyrights that there needs to be some guidance about statutory damages. At the moment, I've done a big study about statutory damages, which shows that there's a lot of inconsistency in statutory damage awards. And although the statute says that those awards should be just, the Principles Project group reached some consensus that that sometimes the awards in these cases are excessive, and one of the things that is a concern to me as a Californian is that many of the companies in the Bay Area and elsewhere who are high technology companies are worried about statutory damages. They're having a chilling effect on innovation, and I think that it would be desirable to provide guidance, and I do in my testimony and elsewhere suggest some of the ways that guidance could be provided. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor. Mr. Siegel, you're the cleanup hitter.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Chairman Coble, Ranking Member Watt, members of the subcommittee, thank you for inviting me to appear today to discuss copyright law and its potential reforms. Copyright has been an important part of our economy and culture since the founding of our nation. But, as Register Pallante has noted, the current law is under stress, brought on by technological change that continues to advance rapidly, and by shifting patterns in the way expressive works are created, disseminated, enjoyed, and reused. Today, the law is straining to remain relevant in the world of smartphones and tablets connected to the internet, and in the face of the demands of consumers who expect to access, use, and share creative works through any device, at any time, in an instant. This stress is reflected in the heated and often strident public debate that copyright policy seems to generate these days. The committee is to be commended for beginning a dialogue about how our copyright system can be improved to meet these new challenges, and I'm honored to contribute to that discussion. I am hopeful that the dialogue will include a wide range of stakeholders and consider a broad set of topics and approaches to reform, and that participants will engage in a manner that is at all times constructive, clear-eyed, and civil. I believe this can be achieved because I've seen that kind of copyright debate take place during the Copyright Principles Project. When Professor Pamela Samuelson asked me to join the project, she explained that the group would have diverse perspectives on copyright, but all members would share a common trait: no sharp elbows, she explained. I was interested in the Principles Project because during my nearly 20 years in copyright, I've watched its public perception deteriorate from a positive, if little known, means of enriching public knowledge to the negative and even hostile manner in which it's sometimes viewed today. In this environment, progress can prove elusive even when there is general support for reform. For example, a broad spectrum of stakeholders support fixing the orphan works problem, but that discussion has at times been heated, and the path to legislative action has been marked more by hurdles than by progress. In my current role at Microsoft, I see firsthand and every day the ways in which copyright law is struggling to keep pace with the dynamic technology environment. As a copyright owner, Microsoft has long relied on copyright to protect our core software products, like Windows and Microsoft Office, and to ensure that our customers enjoy legitimate and safe copies of our software. Our world-class anti-piracy team has created tools based on copyright to make that protection real. From the user side, on the other hand, I've seen how ambiguous areas of the law are sometimes strained to question the ordinary and reasonable personal use of copyrighted works. I'm not talking about piracy here, but situations in which consumers who've legitimately purchased content are confronted and confused by assertions that actions enabling the enjoyment of that content are somehow infringing. This tactic creates needless uncertainty and risk for businesses that are trying to provide tools that simply help consumers communicate and share information in the networked world. These are the dual perspectives I brought to the Copyright Principles Project. In my remaining time, I'd like to highlight three ideas that were discussed in the Principles Project and that will be important in possible reforms. First, the copyright system must understand, accommodate, and support the new generation of creators and business models enabled by the internet that often operate independent of established publishers, distributors, and collective organizations. Often when these authors look to copyright and how it might help them develop and market their works, they are mystified by a system built for traditional modes of distribution and not the new channels. Second, as I noted earlier, the lack of clarity around reasonable and ordinary personal use has contributed to the declining public reputation of copyright and a lack of respect for the law among some consumers. 15 years ago, in the Digital Millennium Copyright Act, Congress helped launch a new wave of online services by establishing a safe harbor that limits the uncertainty and risk faced by telecommunications companies, search engines, and other online businesses. It may be time to consider a safe harbor for consumers, providing certainty that the ordinary and reasonable personal use of legitimately purchased content will be enabled, not stifled, by copyright. As my final point, copyright reform needs to improve the infrastructure of the law, which works best when information about who owns a particular work and where and how to contact the rights owner is available and flows very easily throughout the system. International treaties crafted decades before the digital era prohibit formalities, but given the current extended copyright term and the availability of tools that readily collect and make such ownership information available online, it is time to consider whether the law has the right incentives for dissemination of copyright information at the speed and at the scale that the internet requires. Reform like this can help in many ways. It can address the orphan works problem, remove uncertainty for users, facilitate new uses and new modes of dissemination, and help individual authors obtain real and practical enforcement and respect for their copyright. Thank you again for the opportunity to appear today, and I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you all again for your testimony today. A journalist friend of mine saw me recently, and he said, I note that you sit on the Intellectual Property Subcommittee. How do you like it, he said. I said, I find it very provocative, very interesting. He said, intellectual property law is the most dull, boring law. He didn't say that it induces sleep, but he came close to it. I said, get used to it, because intellectual property is not going away. And thank you again. And folks, we try to comply with the five-minute rule as well. So if you can keep your question, your answers as terse as possible, we will be appreciative. These are to all witnesses, and I'll start with Professor Gassaway. In March, the Register testified before this subcommittee about her top priorities that included such topics as felony streaming and orphan works. What copyright issues are your top priorities? And we'll start with you, Ms. Gassaway, and work our way down to the...
Thank you. Obviously, solving the problem for libraries, archives, and museums, and included in her priorities was also Section 108 and looking at the study group again. And she did reconvene the study group to come back and talk for one day about how we solve what had happened in the 5 years since, I guess it was only 4 years at that time, since the study group report was issued. So that would be my top, to look at that. But the Orphan Works issue is huge, and so is, I actually don't like the term mass digitization, although I guess we'd have to say that's what Google Books and maybe HathiTrust is doing. But many more libraries and archives and museums are doing large digitization projects, but I wouldn't call them mass digitization. And so I think dealing with those issues would be my top.
Thank you, Professor Kavaras.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The five main points of my written testimony are summarized in the last page, but if I had to pick three, I would say clearly modernization of rights and exceptions would be number one. And I do mean modernization, not just adding rights and exceptions, but actually thinking about the existing ones and how they interface. This means the making available right, consumer-related exceptions, and I've mentioned many others in the written testimony. Second point would be to review the licensing structure, which needs to be coherent, flexible, and responsive, and arguably the current one is none of these things, at least in some cases. And finally, review formalities, recordation, how it's linked to remedies would be my third. Thank you.
Professor.
So I agree with Professor Gervais that refining the both the exclusive rights and also thinking in a more systematic way about exceptions and limitations to those rights should be a very high priority. If you look at sections 107 through 121, you see that they are a kind of hodgepodge, and it's difficult to sort of gather what the sort of normative underpinnings of those exceptions really are. And I think thinking about that in a more systematic way would be really beneficial, including a possible safe harbor of the sort that Mr. Siegel mentioned. For me, reform of statutory damages to give guidance, something that also Register Pallante indicated was a priority on her agenda, would be something, and then rethinking registration in a way that will take advantage of the opportunities of the new information technology environment.
Thank you, ma'am.
I would have to say Orphan Works as well. It's an issue I worked on when I was in the Copyright Office and continue to work on at Microsoft. I think it's ripe for action now, and I think the main point is that it's one of the classic areas where the public scratches its head as to what copyright is doing when it potentially interferes with very productive uses of works, even where the copyright owner cannot be located or and probably has no interest in preventing those uses of the works. And I think it would unlock a lot of those works for public consumption and enjoyment. So I think Orphan Works would be a good start towards reinvigorating copyright.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Bumgarner, let me put a question to you. I think I have time for one more question. You were general counsel of the Copyright Office during the last major revision of copyright law through 1976 Copyright Act, based upon a lengthy review of copyright then. What can we learn from that prior experience as we undertake a comprehensive review of copyright law today?
I think, Mr. Chairman, that one thing you can learn is that it's going to take a lot of patience to solve these problems. But I think the patience is not only to be expected of the committee, it's to be expected of the participants in the process as well. I fear that too often people look for a very quick and simple solution to very complex problems simply because technology makes things able to happen, and does not give the copyright community enough time to figure out how they can happen in a more rational means. I think a second thing is tone. I believe one of the distinguishing factors between the revision program in those days, and I remember those hearings all too well, and the copyright debate as it's happening today, and I do not mean in the Copyright Principles Project, there were some big issues, and there were some very strong voices, for example, in the cable television issue. But by and large, the copyright revision debates in the 60s and the 70s were engaged in by people who respected and in many respects loved the copyright law. They thought it needed updating, they thought it needed improvement, but they understood what it did. I think increasing today, outside the confines of the copyright principle projects and some other limited exceptions, the copyright debates today and the search for changes are too often driven by those who are so infused with the promise of new technology and that the promise of the new technology that anything standing in the way is to be lightly and not lightly and simply tossed aside in favor of permitting it to happen.
I thank you, sir. My time has expired. This gentleman from North Carolina, Mr. Watt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As this become my policy, I will defer and go last in the process.
Gentleman from Georgia.
Thank you. I think Ranking Member Watt enjoys putting me first up for some reason. Yeah, all right, I see. But you like to do that with it, so it's not personally directed at me. Okay. All right. Well, I will say that I hope I'm not out of place by offering a letter from the National Writers Union, UAW Local 1981, into the record, which simply, thank you, which simply notes the absence of writers from the Copyright Principles Project, and but I can assure you I appreciate the voluntary nature of what you all did. I think it's good, and I think it serves as a model for what should take place in the future as we embark upon comprehensive copyright reform. Ms. Samuelson, I'm sorry, in your written testimony, you describe U.S. copyright law as a patchwork quilt that is in need of comprehensive reform. Our approach to copyright must be balanced, clear, and forward-thinking. As we take a holistic look at copyright in today's hearing, we should keep in mind that there is not a simple fix to these challenges and that we cannot help one industry or group at the expense of another. We should also be sensitive to the fact that we live in a global society, and this global society has a global economy, and so therefore there is a need for comprehensive reform to U.S. copyright law that is harmonious with the laws of other nations, and perhaps can even lead other nations, but certainly not working without considering the views of international partners. What are the drawbacks, Ms. Samuelson, to a piecemeal approach to copyright?
Thank you for that set of observations and for the questions. I think that part of the problem with patchwork amendments is that over time the statute has become much longer than it was in 1976, and the longer it has become, the more technical it has become, and so it's very difficult to, as I said earlier, to read it through. I know that there has been an effort in Europe by a group of copyright scholars there to articulate a European copyright code draft called the Whittam Group, and it's draft copyright law is basically about 20 pages long. A person can read through the whole thing and understand it. And especially today, it seems to me that we need a law that people can read and can understand. And one of the things that I tried very hard to do, especially in the first part of the Principles Project report, was really to explain copyright in a very straightforward unjargonistic way so that it could help to articulate what are the positive principles that underlie copyright law. I think the norms of copyright and the values that copyright has for our society will be better understood by the public as well as by many of the creators who are whose works are being protected if it in fact is more comprehensible than it is today. And I think you don't get comprehensibility easily when you have 37 years of amendments that get tacked onto the statute.
Yeah, we have the same situation with our tax laws in this country.
Well, unfortunately, the copyright law is beginning to look like the tax.
Well, is if it's that book that is on Chairman Goodlatte's desk, then it's probably worse than the tax code. But I will say, I will ask also, perhaps you could help us in that regard if the Europeans have some kind of 20-page tax tax document, that would be great. But listen, how important is it that comprehensive U.S. Copyright reform take into consideration international standards?
I think that to the extent that U.S. law can be compatible with the laws of other nations, that actually assists the United States in being able to talk effectively to other nations and to conform their practices and our practices. I think it helps in enforcement. It is one of the reasons why I thought that the communication to the public right is something that we should be considering. The United States is the only country in the world, so far as I know, that has a public display right. That's a right that hasn't been used very much. People don't actually know what it means. If you took it literally, you might have to shut down the internet, and that doesn't seem like a good idea. So thinking about sort of how we could think in a more comprehensive way about what the role of the different exclusive rights are and how we can foster international conversations and agreement on that seems to me all to the good.
Thank you. I yield back.
I thank the gentleman, the distinguished gentleman from Pennsylvania, Mr. Barreto.
Thank you, Chairman. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for being here. And Professor Samuels and in your committee, if I may refer to it as that, I want to commend you folks on what you've accomplished thus far. It's very helpful to me. Mr. Siegel, am I pronouncing that right?
Siegel.
Siegel. All right. I'm sorry. Let's move into, I don't want to get too far down in the weeds because this is a review and we need responses from all sides before we come to a conclusion. And that will take a while, as the chairman said. But let's move into the digital arena for a moment. And can you give me your opinion as to what could be done that is not being done by internet providers concerning downloading of music, movies, purchasing of items that are pirated here in the United States and around the world?
Well, as you probably know from our perspective at Microsoft, piracy is a serious problem and it continues to be a problem, and we're very keenly interested in addressing it in effective ways. Our approach to online piracy focuses on the notice and takedown system that is built on top of the Digital Millennium Copyright Act that I referenced. And our anti-piracy team works very hard to make that system as efficient as possible so that they can get information about where our works are being pirated and those works can be taken down as quickly as possible. Okay. And so we work with internet providers around the world to make sure that that system is as effective as possible, and we think that's really the right approach to take in dealing with the online piracy problem from our perspective as a software provider.
All right. Professor Gazaway, as a law student, can you give me some examples of where you would like to see changes concerning research that a law student would have to perform concerning photocopying, using specific verbatim in preparing briefs, for example, and where that should not be permitted?
Well, let me start by saying that photocopying is almost dead in law schools.
I think I just dated myself, or you did that
right.
for me.
Okay, I was in college. Remember when we got our first photocopier
yes,
at Texas
yeah, it was
Women's
great,
University?
Wasn't it? Well, let's say drawing up digitally the material and
right,
printing
right.
it out.
Yes. Most of that is licensed. So for law, we may be the wrong discipline to actually be looking at, because with Lexis and Westlaw and then what the federal courts and state courts put online, we are sort of in a unique position that we've either got it from a commercial source or we've got it free on the internet when we're talking about our primary legal materials. But what we don't have so much free really is, and I guess I shouldn't say free because law schools do pay, law students don't, but we do pay. I think it's something like the University of North Carolina pays something like $80,000 a year for law schools, law students' free access, but it's free to the student. But other materials are not so available. And increasingly, even in legal briefs, we are seeing interdisciplinary materials, whether they are science and technology related or something else. The other thing we are beginning to see is multimedia. You know, when most of us were in law school, it was your textbook and a legal pad, and that was about it. But now we're seeing students, you know, who are using video clips and faculty who are using them. And so all types of works need to be available and part of this research database, and I'm going to use that in a, or I should say databases. It may be licensed, maybe not.
Okay, thank you. Professor Samuelson, let's stay with the law school concept here for a moment. And you jogged my memory, Professor Gazaway, concerning a professor who's preparing a curriculum and lectures and is pulling information off the internet from legal scholars, from individuals who write treatises and so on. What do you think we should do with that? Should it be more regulated or less regulated, and why?
So I think that the norms of the academy actually, in general, respect copyright. Most of us who are academics are authors, and we care actually about misuses of our work, and I think that that helps to create a culture in an academic environment in which respect for copyright is more likely to occur than perhaps in some other sectors. In respect of the activities of professors, it is the case that we draw upon many types of works. I still actually like photocopies sometimes myself, but I am really quite careful about this, partly because I'm a copyright person. And I think that my colleagues also are now making much greater use of online materials. As Professor Gazaway mentioned, much of that material is licensed, and we have access to many journals that we don't have on our shelves now. And I think licensing has become a solution to a lot of problems in this domain.
Thank you. My time has expired.
Thank the gentleman. The gentlelady from California, Ms. Hsu.
Professor Samuelson, I appreciate the efforts that you and the project participants put into the report. And I think it's so important that the participants came together in the spirit of having a civil discussion on many complicated and controversial issues. However, I'm concerned that the report didn't include the input from a creator's view, someone who could give an on-the-ground practical perspective, such as a writer, a musician, or a filmmaker. And in fact, as a co-chair of the Congressional Creative Rights Caucus, I feel that there should have been creators even in today's hearing. So I'd like to ask you, Professor Samuelson, to what extent were the interests and perspectives of the individual creator considered during the project, and why weren't they directly involved?
So it's the case that I hope that many conversations take place and many different creative communities are invited to participate in the kind of conversation that this committee seems intent on doing. And, you know, if I had to have a representative of each of the creative industries participating in it. It would have been a group of 50, and I think you can't have a good conversation about some of these issues with a large number of people. So I believe that both as creators ourselves and also as people who enjoy the arts and who respect copyright, that in fact we were keeping in mind the interests of individual creators, and we hope just to start a conversation, not to say that because we had this conversation that that necessarily meant that that's whatever we might think is the way that everyone else should think. We hope that 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 this discourse that we shared with the public through this report is something that would foster more more conversation and more communication. So I don't believe that we sort of were excluding the interests of creators at all. In fact, I think we were very much keeping the interests of creators in mind.
Well, Professor, I think that if there were individual creators, the issue of the Digital Millennia Copyright Act might come up. In particular, the abuse of DMCA takedown notices, which is not addressed actually in your report. And that's of concern to me, considering this is a big challenge for individual creators. They're often trying to keep up with issuing thousands of notices to infringing sites, and a lucky few can afford to hire a service to do it. What's most frustrating is that these sites claim to remove the infringing file only to have the same identical file reappear on the same site within a few hours. And in fact, David Lowery in his op-ed called it a whack-a-mole process. So how can individual creators keep it up with a game that they can't ever seem to win? Is there a better way than that could be more meaningful than the current DMCA process for them to effectively address this rampant infringement of their works on the internet?
So thank you for the question. I do recognize that individual creators are at some disadvantage, that they don't have the resources that Microsoft, for example, has to police online infringement, and I am concerned about that. I do think that Congress went through a very careful process in 1998 to think about sort of how the rules for taking material down should be handled, and they came up with a particular solution, the notice and takedown, and if it's not working effectively, I do think that it would be worth having that be part of your agenda. For in terms of the agenda of the Principles Project, it wasn't to say that we could take on every single issue that that might be out there. We gave the opportunity to our members to raise issues that were of concern to them, and those are the ones that we addressed in the report.
Well, I did also want to ask one last question, which is our current U.S. copyright law has enhanced and delivered substantial benefits to our economy, and I'm concerned what would happen if our copyright law was watered down. Commerce recognized recently that resource-intensive copyright industries such as movies and music have contributed greatly to our GDP, and in fact, figures have been underreported over the years. They are now looking to revise decades of official economic figures. In fact, creative works are truly our most precious export, creating a positive trade balance. So what are the implications if we do not have a strong copyright framework like we currently have?
So I don't think anything in the Copyright Principles Project report was recommending watering down or weakening U.S. copyright law, but really trying to make it more effective. So to me, the proposals and the suggestions that were being made are ones that would continue to foster the growth and strength of the U.S. copyright industries.
Thank you. I yield back.
I thank the gentlelady. The gentleman from Virginia, Mr. Kidlat.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me start by pursuing the line of questioning that Ms. Chu started. I'll ask each of you, how is copyright working for the individual artist who wants to maximize the use of his or her talents instead of having to spend time understanding and using copyright law to protect their rights? So, Mr. Baumgarten, you want to take a shot at that?
I will. I think the notion in many circles that the copyright law has become totally dysfunctional and counterproductive is not the way the situation is. If I look around, I see services and means of creation and dissemination, many under copyright owner control, more of which probably should be under copyright control, thriving. I don't think the copyright system is broken or dysfunctional. I think it may need some updating and improvement. I'm not sure how much. I will not purport to speak for individual creators. I spent too much of the last copyright revision as an ally of one of the strongest creators representatives that ever lived, Irwin Karp. And if I purported to speak for individual creators, I'm afraid what Mr. Karp's specter would do to me. I will say, though, in partial response to your question, and
you're going to have to be quick because I've got five people, and I'd like to ask more than one question.
In partial response to the question that was just asked by Ms. Chu, that I want to make it absolutely certain that I do not purport to speak for individual creators. I represented them many times early in my career, and I worked as allies with them. But their interests were not overlooked completely. They weren't presented as eloquently, perhaps, as Mr. Lowry or others were. But, for example, on the question of the...
Let me go to Professor Gassaway. I appreciate that.
Thank you.
I've got to let some other people say some things, too.
Mr. Goodlatte, I believe that we do have a problem when it comes to individual creators. And I think if you talk to a lot of the people in the user community, they want to do things for the individual creator. The resentment has come, I think, with big publishers, big companies, big record companies. The way our Copyright Act is structured, individual owners have to pursue their rights, and litigation is the way they do that. And it is, I think it's unfortunate, but we don't, as a society, have much of a way so far to deal with that. We favor the big guys, sorry.
Professor, is it Gervais?
Yes. Thank you, Chairman Goodlatte. It's at the high level, copyright policy is very easy. We need creators, users, and ways to connect them. And it seems the debate is always focused on that part in the middle. And it's a very important part. These commercial intermediaries obviously are important. I say in my written testimony there should be healthy competition. But for creators really want two things typically. They want attribution. We've heard that. But professional creators need a way to monetize their work. I mean, I live in Nashville. I don't think we would have had George Jones, or we'd have...
They probably want to have more than one way to monetize their work, right? I mean, they may want to do their own thing, be independent, have a simple system where they can have their copyright royalties, rewards, however they enforce that on their own, or they may want to license with one of these big entities that you refer to so that they can completely focus on their work and let someone else take care of it. Obviously, you're going to pay a premium for doing that, but you certainly want to have that option. Those are two, but there may well be more as well. Professor Sampson?
So I think it would be worthwhile for there to be more empirical studies about the interests of individual creators and how copyright system is working for them or not. I think that's an empirical question. The National Academy of Sciences just published a report suggesting that more empirical research should be done in respect of copyright, and as part of a kind of comprehensive reform, it would seem to me that this might be a good time to engage in some of that empirical research. The one thing that the Copyright Principles Project identified that I think address the issue, the interests of small individual creators, is a small claims court. That right now litigation costs are so high that many people who...
Before my time runs out, I'm going to start a second question that's a compliment to all of you. I mentioned in my opening remarks, but I want to ask you, based on your joint experience working together to find at least some common ground, what advice would you give to your colleagues about how they can perhaps do the same? And many of them are sitting right behind you. We'll start with Mr. Siegel.
That's a very, very good and interesting question to think about. From my sort of personal perspective, one of the things that I think did not happen in our discussions is I think we avoided the good versus evil stories, and we didn't try to characterize either side as in a drama, in a sense, and focused really on trying to understand the interests where the other side potentially was coming from, so that we could, you know, modify our remarks to make sure that we could communicate our interests to the others as well. And I think that helps in these kinds of discussions, because, you know, copyright should be a very functional, pragmatic discussion, and really shouldn't be about drama or heated rhetoric.
Ms. Baumgart?
Tough question. Listen to each other and try to search for a solution rather than yell at each other, I guess.
Stop being so polarized. Think about the needs of society and our economy, what enriches our lives, and how do we make works available that do that? I think that's what we need to focus on, rather than just representing a client.
Professor Gervais?
Yes, I would say I hear a lot of people saying that they speak on behalf of the public interest. If I may, I think the public interest requires that copyright work for the three categories of people I was identifying earlier: creators, users, and the people who connect them.
Professor Samson.
I think having a holistic understanding that the copyright is now an ecosystem and that it has multiple parts and multiple stakeholders, and that each of them has a role to play in trying to help us get to the right kind of balance. I think that if you start conversations in a way that promote that kind of mutual respect, you're more likely to end up with something that actually is both comprehensible and also is considered fair and just, and that's what we're looking for.
Well, thank you. Mr. Chairman, I've abused my time here by letting them all answer the... Oh, I'm sorry, yes. So I also want to ask unanimous consent to enter into the record the Copyright Alliance's statement that they prepared for this hearing, and I very much appreciate their doing that and want to have this entered into the record.
Without objection.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, sir. The distinguished gentleman from Florida.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I want to begin by thanking you for holding this hearing and starting what I hope will be a robust and comprehensive review of copyright law. We all know the challenges that any substantive discussion of copyright law has in this, shall I say, rhetorically charged, Twitterized environment we live in. These are complex issues, and they don't lend themselves to easy sound bites. It's important to recognize the tremendous success of our current system. We live in a nation in which creation has thrived in large part due to the protections guaranteed to creators under our Constitution and detailed in our copyright law. Millions of Americans depend on copyright for their livelihood, from the songwriters, musicians, actors, directors, and writers creating the music, movies, shows, and stories that speak to us all, to the music publishers and the programmers, the app developers, and the web designers who help works find audiences, not to mention the carpenters, engineers, and countless others who contribute to the creative works. It's a great American success story, but there are challenges. We all know how easy it is to steal content. Our copyright system needs to encourage ways to deliver the great content we all love to the public while allowing for new transformative technologies to continue to be developed in the future. But let's remember that even the most innovative technology in this area relies upon the innovative creators whose work has to be protected. Our copyright laws may once have impacted only a narrow subset of people. That's been a theme of this discussion. But thanks to the transformative advances of technologies in recent years, we're truly living in a world where copyright impacts nearly all of us. As an avid music lover, I've been able to enjoy my favorite artists and discover new ones in ways I never would have dreamed of in the 70s and 80s when I was listening to records on my combination turntable 8-track player. The way that consumers interact with these works has changed not only the way the content is delivered, but frequently the way that it is created. And these are all positive developments as long as we keep the foundation of our copyright system intact. The belief that a creator has the right to get paid fairly for their ideas and creative contributions, or as the Constitution puts it, in order to promote the progress of science and useful arts by securing for limited times to authors and inventors the exclusive right to their respective writings and discoveries. That's the fundamental principle upon which the whole complex copyright system rests, and any changes must help grow the pie so that legal streaming technologies and apps can take off and succeed, with both the creators and the tech companies jointly reaping the benefits. If any changes are made to our system, they have to be done with all stakeholders sitting down together, as you have said, at the same table, including the public, the creators, and the technology companies. As lawmakers, however, we cannot be intimidated by those voices that simply want to stifle all reasonable reform. I appreciate the chairman's approach, and from my conversations with Mr. Goodlatte, I know that he is also committed to giving everyone a voice in this review process, and I want to commend both of you for that approach and that good work. Advancing technologies may have made copyright issues more complex, but Mr. Chairman, if the committee decides to modify the Copyright Act, I hope that we do it in a way that makes it easier for people to understand. Right now, that's not always the case for consumers, for investors, or even for creators, and so while I wouldn't say that the CPP paper should be the foundation of a comprehensive reform, I'd like to delve into just one of the issues that it raises related to complexity. Professor Samuelson, Recommendation 7 of the report specifically calls for establishing a right of communication to the public in order to simplify the law and make it conceptually more coherent. Today, cable and satellite retransmissions and digital transmissions via the internet are dealt with either as performances or distributions or displays or reproductions. And in a mobile and online world, most people don't have any idea whether they're enjoying a performance or a distribution or a display or a reproduction, much less what the rights are. So the report says that the right of communication is the international norm. Could you just explain how that approach works elsewhere in the world?
Well, Professor Gervais may have more information than me about how the communication right is practiced elsewhere, but it is my understanding that broadcast, for example, of television signals and the like, is handled through a communication right. And I think transmissions of different sorts, digital transmissions as well as broadcast transmissions, I think fit more easily under that kind of right, and I think it's my understanding that that's the kind of practice, and that part of what happened with the public performance right in the United States is at the time that the 76 Act was put in place, that cable television transmission had been deemed not a performance, so the statute was amended to add it, rather than thinking about the communication to the public right as an alternative framework. So in some sense, we're kind of stuck with something that was a response to one particular technology at the time, and we're sort of now bundling transmissions under different kinds of rights, and I think we don't have a coherent view about that. And I think if we were engaged in a comprehensive review of copyright, we could say, this is the work that the communication right does, this is the work that the public performance right does, this is the work that the reproduction right serves, and so forth. And it seems to me that that would be something that would be very helpful, especially going forward, as we try to understand how these rights should apply in these environments.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, General from Florida. The distinguished gentleman from
Texas.
From Tampa. He came in late.
He just walked back in. He was here earlier.
Gentleman from Texas, Mr. Poe.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank you and Chairman Goodlatte for holding this first of a whole lot more hearings. Copyright law is difficult. My friend and lawyer, Mr. Marino, is going through the copyright law. He is finding out that it is twice as long as War and Peace and not near as funny. And Professor Gassaway, when I was at the University of Houston, I studied enough copyright and patent law to spend the rest of my career up into coming to Congress in the criminal justice area. Stealing and killing and robbing is a whole lot easier to understand than copyright law. So, but I appreciate the five of you, your work in this area. Is difficult, it's complex, and it needs fixing. And that's what we're going to try to do with the chairman's lead. The law has existed for 200 years, and it's It's been good. America is better because we have the concept of copyright. During the Cold War, I think part of the reason that we got successful in the Cold War was because of the communication that was done by people in the copyright business, and songs and movies, all of that concept was able to go worldwide and helped help us win the Cold War. But there are a lot of other examples as well, but it has been good for the country. We certainly don't want to, as Congress sometimes does, when we start working on things, we make a system worse than better. We want to make sure we don't do that. All these folks in the audience here are saying amen to that, I know, because they don't want us to make the system worse because they have us, our stakeholders, in it. Let me ask this question, a specific question. I have four questions to all four of you, or five of you. Current system, the law that Professor Marino's going through here, what is good in it? We'll talk about the good and the bad and the ugly. Let's just talk about the good. What is good in the law right now? Mr. Siegel, we'll start on this end and go the other direction. Any of it?
I think there's a fair amount that is good. As I mentioned, I think the Section 512, the Digital Millennium Copyright Act for online services, is a very positive development. I think the set of remedies and the way certainly the U.S. legal system works is a very useful thing for copyright owners and authors and creators to use to protect their copyrights. I think the protections in for the use of technological measures in Section 1201 are by and large a positive force that are used by both small creators and larger copyright owners. So I think there's a lot that is valuable. I think it's certainly, as others on the panel have mentioned, that one of the things about this project was everyone agreed that there's a lot valuable and beneficial in the current system that, as you've said, needs to be preserved and protected and not interfered with. It becomes a question of what amendments can make it better and stronger, especially in the eyes of consumers.
Professor Samuelson?
So I agree with Mr. Siegel that there is much in U.S. copyright law today that is valuable and worth preserving.
Like what?
So specifically, the copyright protects original works of authorship from the moment of their fixation for a period of time. That principle is one that was novel in its day. There was a time when only published works were protected by U.S. copyright law, so I think that's something that we all thought was a valuable thing. A second valuable thing is that copyright protects the expression in a work, not ideas, processes, procedures, facts, data, knowledge. That way, second comers can basically extract unprotected elements and make new works of authorship, and that goes a long ways toward producing ongoing creation that advances the constitutional purpose. I think there's a consensus that the fair use provision of U.S. copyright law has done much good by enabling copyright law to adapt during times of change. And so some uses aren't fair, but some uses are, and I think courts have more or less done a pretty good job in applying fair use in these areas. And so while I could go on, I think those three examples are some of my favorites.
I'm out of time. I'd like the rest of you to be specific in answering that question other than what's already in your testimony, and submit that. Plus the other question, what's the worst part about the copyright law we have? So we'll talk about the good and the bad, and we'll get to the ugly some other day. So the worst part and the best part. And I'll yield back, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
I thank the gentleman from Texas, the gentlelady from California.
Yes, thank you very much, Mr. Poe. Maybe I'll ask that question if I have enough time. I wanted to ask a question about the report. It says in the report that personal uses do not involve copyright's main job of providing authors with the means of controlling commercial exploitation of their works. So I wanted to know, anyone on the panel, if you could help me understand what exactly that means And then isn't every instance of someone downloading or streaming a song or a movie or a photograph for their personal enjoyment an example of commercial exploitation?
I'll take a crack at it, if I may. I'll try to be brief because I spend too much time giving speeches about personal use in the past. Over the years, I've represented a great number of clients whose job, whose investments, whose capital, whose creative energy in terms of individual creators has been in creating, replicating, and disseminating works to individuals for their personal use and enjoyment. I've always been troubled by the fact that now, because individuals can do it for themselves, and because major industries can grow up developing technologies and systems and services to enable consumers to fulfill their own needs, that somehow the idea has grown that personal use should be an exemption from copyright. Doesn't make any sense to me. There may be newer ways to deal with it that are required. Technology may enable those very newer ways to do it. But there is a recognition in the report that there are severe issues with simply considering personal use to be an exempted field of activity. And I think some of those are, as I said, acknowledged in the report itself.
Thank you very much. I wanted to ask you a question about international copyright. The World Intellectual Property Organization is going to be meeting next month, actually, in Morocco, and dealing with the whole issue of tweaking international copyright for the visually impaired. And I wanted to know if you were concerned about that process. I've heard some concerns from some areas. I wanted to know if you had the same concerns.
If I may take that, thank you for your question. Indeed, there's a diplomatic conference that is scheduled to adopt this treaty. So this is a treaty that would, in a way, make an exemption mandatory for visually impaired users. And I don't know that anyone disagrees with the normative side of it, which is this is a good idea, but there have been concerns raised in particular as to the application of the so-called three-step test, which is the test for exceptions under international rules recently. I certainly personally support this treaty, but it, I think, is an example that a more comprehensive approach, not just domestically, but in fact internationally, might work better, because if you push this one treaty that has one new right or one new exception, it's harder to get people to rally around that, even for something that seems as fairly obvious as the visually impaired.
I thought actually that was part of the problem, that part of the concern was to open it up and to look at it in a broader way might raise many more concerns and might compromise copyright, no?
I meant broader, not just broader in terms of more exceptions, but a more broader reform of international copyright. There are rights missing and there are exceptions missing. And I think that broader discussion needs to happen, but there's really no clear leadership internationally right now to make that happen. We've had international treaties, the Berne Convention, but the U.S. joined that convention once it was all wrapped up, so it was too late to influence it from the inside. Since then, we've had the TRIPS Agreement, the World Trade Organization, mm-hmm. but it didn't do very much in terms of copyright. It was mostly an enforcement-based instrument from the copyright perspective. So, and since then, we've had partial efforts, ACTA, now there's a TPP and all these things, but they're all very partial, and I kind of wonder if that's the best way forward, to have all these parallel instruments, and there are countries that are proposing counter treaties to the treaties now.
Right.
I'm a little worried about where that's going, and I think if the U.S.
Which countries? I certainly know there's some concerns around Nigeria, or rather a person representing Nigeria. It's not necessarily the country, but which other countries are proposing?
So there's something that I referred to in my written testimony. The official jargon is super regional meetings, and some of them have taken place in Latin America, some of them have taken place in Africa, and basically these are countries that are having meetings where the Europeans and the Americans are simply not invited, and their argument is, well, you're having a meeting, we're not invited to. And I'm not sure that's a very healthy development. And if you're a U.S. exporter of copyrighted material, I would think you might be a little worried about having a picture where each country develops different norms. Mm-hmm. So I think that leadership to update the entire system, or at least to look at the possibility of doing that, might work better.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you.
gentleman from Georgia, Mr. Collins.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate your leadership on this issue and the commitment that you've shown along with Chairman Goodlett to discussing the Copyright Act in an objective and non-polarizing manner. Although technology has developed far beyond what our founders could have imagined, their genius remains as true today as it was when they crafted the copyright clause in Article 1. There seems to be a tendency, however, in this day and age, to frame the idea of free and open access to creative rights as a moral imperative. Those who believe in the right of an individual to capitalize on their creation, be it a work of art, music, or a brilliant reshaping of the English language in a written work, are portrayed as anti-innovation and as outdated as the flip phone that my father currently uses. But our founders understood what many of us have forgotten. Unless we incentivize creators to create by giving them the rights of ownership to their works, innovation will truly cease to exist. Everything has an owner. I've said it before, and I'll continue to say it. Unless the law encourages the creative genius in a person to take risks, both professional and financial, by ensuring appropriate protection of their intellectual property, then the law does a disservice to what the framers intended in the copyright clause. I would be remiss if I did not mention that I do have concerns with the CCP report, concerns about the lack of artist involvement, concerns about the conclusions reached, and concerns about this same abandonment and disregard of the fact that copyright protection finds its origins in our Constitution. Make no mistake, however, I recognize and strongly support the economic vibrancy created by the technology sector. In my home state of Georgia, there are over 13,000 technology companies employing over 250,000 men and women. Georgia also continues to see record growth in the number of tech startups. In fact, Atlanta is one of the top five startup centers in the entire country. I am proud of the business environment we've created in Georgia to allow this industry to thrive. I firmly believe that protecting copyright leads to more creation and more innovation and even more growth in every sector that relies on the ideas and ingenuity of individuals. Although I appreciate the witnesses being here and I have fully read their testimony and the report, I do not have any questions for them today. And Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
You win the prize, Mr. Collins. The gentle lady from Washington is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just want to thank you for holding this hearing and thank all the witnesses for taking the time to be here today. When the registrar was here for a hearing, she mentioned that when all the work was going on for the Copyright Act in 1976, she said by the time it got done, it was already out of date because it took about 15 years to do it, and many sections of it were from many years before the final passage date. So here we are today looking at things, and I know your report is from 2010 already, and so my first question would be, what's even changed between 2010 and now, whether it's court decisions or technology changes that you weren't able to anticipate when you wrote the report that you think are important for us to have on our radar now? And anyone who has some feedback on that would be helpful.
I think we probably all would have different answers. My answer is that I'm concerned about what's happening in the courts, which is something I never used to think. I was pretty happy with the way the decisions were going. But the decisions now in the area of fair use and in the area of public dissemination of works, particularly in the Second Circuit, I think those have changed. Some on the Principles Project would applaud those changes. I think some of us would not applaud those changes.
Others? Professor Gervais.
Very brief answer. Thank you for your question. I think one predictable and one less predictable change. The predictable change is the fact that the focus, even in 3 years, has visibly shifted from hard enforcement online to more licensing, more authorization, more streaming, more content legally available, which I think was predictable and is a good thing. If I had to point to one unpredictable change, it's the Supreme Court reading of the statute in the first sale case known as Kurtzang, but it's not a digital case, so I don't think that it impacts the CPP conclusions.
Okay, thank you.
I think that one of the major changes has been the so-called mass digitization projects. They were just beginning at the time that we completed our work, really, and Google was underway, but with libraries and archives beginning to do them and looking at ways to do them, does it need to be licensed? You know, how are we going to do this? Mm-hmm.
So I think that cloud computing and mobile devices were not really in contemplation as we were talking through our deliberations about the act, but I think something that came out of our deliberations, which I think is something that can carry forward, is a notion that if we find a way to articulate what the right balance is, and we can identify exclusive rights and some exceptions to those rights that become comprehensible, that become predictable, that they can, in fact, advance over time and get applied to new things. So I think we've learned a lot of lessons, but I think that part of the challenge for this revision has got to be comprehensibility, this kind of flexibility, building in some flexibility, but also keeping the norms at a level of generality so that the law doesn't become obsolete. I don't want to have an exclusive right to control this aspect of cloud computing because that's going to go out of fashion. So trying to sort of figure out what's the right way to frame the rights and exceptions that might be needed to them, I think is something that we have learned something about over the last several years. Mm-hmm.
I would say it's the proliferation of devices and cloud services, not only that they exist more so than they did in 2010, but that people are really using them and they're becoming integrated into their lives and the way they communicate with their families, their friends. And what happens, what that means is, what another positive development that has happened is that a lot more legitimate entertainment services are being delivered over those devices and over the internet, which is, again, as Professor Gervais pointed out, the win-win, where authorized uses are being made and creators are being compensated. But it's also changing the way that consumers expect to interact with the content that they find very important and, as has been said, makes those devices and services valuable. And that's probably not going to change. That's going to continue, and it's very hard to keep up with that dynamic expectations of consumers around what they find important in their devices and their technology.
Now, you talked earlier, Mr. Siegel, about transparency, and that you think that's an area where we could do a lot more. Can you elaborate a little bit more on that?
Yes, there's a obvious need to have better access to information about who owns what copyrights and what those copyright owners would like, who they are, how you contact them, what you can and can't do with their works. I think the thing, and the first thought is always that the Copyright Office can build a better database for people to use. I think the Principles Project talks about an idea, rather than do that, what the Copyright Office should get in the business of doing is tapping into the already existent private registries of copyright information, the database that ASCAP and BMI use for songwriters, the Copyright Clearance uses for authors of journals and textual materials, the ways photographers are distributing their works online. All of that information exists. It's very conducive to the way authors exploit their works and get paid for their works. If the office can somehow give some legal significance to those databases and therefore give those authors access to the remedies that are keyed to making that information available, I think that would be a very efficient way to help improve the flow of information. And in that way, authors get very practical enforcement. If someone knows that there's an author standing behind that work and they don't want it used in a certain way, those folks will probably restrain that use without ever having to take them to litigation or do anything that requires expensive outlays by those authors. I think that's the approach that's described in the project as a way to help this information flow problem.
Thank you very much, and my time has expired. I yield back, Mr. Chair.
I thank the gentlelady. The chair recognizes the other distinguished gentleman from North Carolina, Mr. Holdy.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Our chairman is known with great affection amongst the North Carolina delegation as our leader. So it's a pleasure to be with him today, and I want to thank the witnesses. I'd like to hearken back to something that Chairman Goodlatte was touching on in his questioning, and it referred to the CPP process that you all have gone through was successful in large part because you weren't throwing sharp elbows and you kind of ratcheted down the level of hostility in the discourse and so forth. So I'd like to ask, why do you think the current copyright policy discussions have become so polarizing and antagonistic just in the last few years and just run through the panel and get some idea of what has caused that. Mr. Segal?
Well, I think it starts by showing how important creativity is to both the persons who create the works and to the consumers and others who use them. I mean, these are incredibly important things to both sides of the debate because they're matters of intense labor and time spent by the creators and also the free expression and people's personalities about the works they care deeply about. So you start from a place that is very important to the participants in the debate. And I think that's, by and large, the good thing about copyright. The copyright is an engine for the creation of these things that people feel so important about. The question is, how do you go from that positive feeling and import of these issues to a rational debate about the law? That's the tricky part. But I think it starts from a positive sense that these issues are important and something that people do care deeply about.
Professor? Of course, there are positive influences and so forth, but I'm particularly interested in what are the negative influences that are ratcheting up the antagonism in the debate.
So I think it's partly a reaction to the huge disruption that the internet and advances in information technology have enabled. There was a hope, there was a sense that that. In the future, that people would be able to control their content better than before through digital rights management technologies and the like, and then to discover that those technical protection measures, while they are useful and important, are not actually being quite as effective as I think many hoped, means that there's a kind of sense of loss of control that has made people extra nervous about things. And I think peer-to-peer file sharing and the willingness of people to engage in that activity in the millions has been something that's created a kind of toxic environment. Now, I think that we're working our way out of that because there are more opportunities now to get more legal content, and people are taking advantage of those. So we may be working our way out of that particular problem, but I do think that that's contributed to the polarization. And
yeah, just to follow up on that just a bit, you say we might be working our way out of that. Now, we don't know what the next new technological advancement is going to be. I mean, we were just talking about what's happened in the last 3 years and what we could not have foreseen. But if we are, knowing what you know, if we are working our way out of it towards a better place, I mean, do you have any horizon for that?
I wish I did.
Okay. Well, quickly, Professor, if you could just touch on my original question.
Yes.
Quickly, because I'd like to get the other comments as well.
I'll be very, very brief. So, copyright is what allows creators and a lot of businesses to function and to live. So obviously, when you touch it, people get very nervous. But the thing with the CPP, I think we all agree, it could be a lot better. So if you look at it from a distance, some improvements are pretty clear. The problem also is that when regulation is in the books that is not particularly good, there are people who take advantage of that structure. So if you change it for something better, they might not be happy. So
they take advantage of that and turn it into a business model which makes a lot of money. It fuels the antagonism.
Exactly.
All right, Professor.
I actually think that this sort of disagreement began to rise really in the early 1980s. We began to see it even over photocopying. I think it also tracks a general lack of civility in society. I mean, in the legal profession, we see it and, get warned about it. And I think we have to return to the days when compromise is not a dirty word.
Mr. Baumgarten, do you have a final comment?
I suggested earlier, I think some aspects of the framework have changed. I think what had been a discussion of how to respectfully fix copyright law has in some quarters become a discussion of how to diminish the obstacles posed by copyright law to the promise of technologies that we know today and technologies that will come tomorrow, and treat copyright law as just another impediment to be dispensed with. I don't suggest that everyone is guilty of that, but when that attitude comes and there's a counter from the other side and things get loud, and more importantly, things get distrustful, and I think that's what's missing today is a lot of trust.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
I thank the gentleman, the distinguished gentleman from New York.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And let me thank the panel for your work as it relates to the project, as well as for your very thoughtful testimony today. I think I'll start with Professor Samuelson. In the context of the congressional obligation to protect creative works, it obviously is an obligation that stems from a constitutional charge, Article 1, Section 8, Clause 8. In the context of the project or of the work that you've done academically, what can you tell us on the committee about the thought process that the founding fathers undertook in including what was a groundbreaking provision in the heart of the Constitution, when so many other complex things were being discussed? Obviously, separation of powers, the Electoral College, checks and balances, federalism. And this was a complex document, yet the founding fathers saw fit to include this provision to promote, obviously, scientific works and useful arts. What can you tell us about what the founding fathers were thinking?
Well, I think one thing we can know is that many of the founding fathers, as we often call them, were authors and publishers and people who were engaged in learning and scientific knowledge advancement. So this was something that they actually cared about. Secondly, many of the states, in fact, most of the states in the what's now the United States, had already had individual copyright and patent laws. They weren't all the same. And if you wanted to form a nation and you wanted for works, let's say, published in New York to be able to easily be protected in Georgia, then having a national law, having a uniform national law, was something that was seen, I think, as something really valuable. So I think it was in order to help the transition to a more national way of disseminating knowledge that that was part of the motivation of the founders.
And that presumably is still a principle that holds great merit today.
Yes, absolutely.
Now, with respect to the challenge that I think the committee faces as it undertakes this comprehensive review, we have this constitutional charge, of course, to protect science and protect innovation, protect people's creative genius in the artistic field as well, but also do it in a way that allows for technological innovation to flourish and to not be stymied. Can anyone on the panel comment as to how we strike that appropriate balance moving forward in a very complex commercial environment that exists right now?
Thank you. That is truly the core question, I think. What I said earlier about a law that works for creators, users, and people who connect them, I think holds and is the best way to answer. So if the statute allows companies to flourish in the way that they help produce and distribute content without frustrating users, I think the system will work better. And the way that I captured that in my written testimony and in my opening remarks was to say we should focus on maximizing authorized uses of material as opposed to focusing first on minimizing unauthorized uses. And I think we're moving in that direction.
Now, to follow up on that observation, one of the challenges that, of course, we face is that as the technology develops rapidly, we have to put into place statutes that accommodate the changing technology. We face that issue now as it relates to piracy. Originally, it was unlawful reproduction and distribution, and now it's largely done through illegal streaming. On that point, would you support, or does the group support, strengthening penalties to deal with the essential change in the manner in which piracy is taking place over the internet right now?
You want to say something?
Well, I think as I said before, piracy is a problem, and we'd certainly support looking at ways to help address the problem, especially for individual creators. I think as a company that also builds online services that people are used to communicate, we have the opposite concern that any new measures to help on the piracy side might go too far and overreach and cut back on people's ability to use the technology for perfectly legitimate purposes. So you always got to strike the right balance, and it's difficult. But certainly considering both of those at the same time is really the critical aspect of trying to figure out ways to really help the copyright owner, but not go too far and chilling the legitimate use.
Thank you, and I see, Mr. Chairman, that my time has expired.
I thank the gentleman from New York. The distinguished gentleman from Florida is recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you to the guest. Professor Samuelson, the group, how was that group assembled?
I talked to Mary Beth Peters. I talked to some of the practicing lawyers that I knew. I talked to some law professors that I was in. I knew, and I. This was basically the use of some social networks to try to bring a group of people together that I thought would be able to have this kind of thoughtful civil discourse.
Because I guess some have said, well, you know, there's really not, there's a dearth of perspective of independent artists and creators who basically depend on copyright for every day of what they do. So do you think that you got sufficient input from those types of individuals?
So I think that it's important to recognize that most of the academics on the panel are actually authors of books, and those books actually bring in some income for those people. And I think the other thing is that when we have been teaching copyright law for decades or practicing copyright law for decades, as is true of all the people who were participating, I think that we have been taking into account the interests of others, including small creators as well as large creators. So as I said earlier, I think it's really important as this process goes forward for you to hear from all manner of different creator communities and individuals and groups. One project of the sort that I tried to assemble really couldn't reach out to every particular community. And so we tried to have as broad a perspective as we could while recognizing that this was just hopefully the start of a conversation rather than the end of a conversation.
Very well. The report, I think, focuses on copyright and the parameters thereof, really focusing on economic and utilitarian principles, not as much as it being kind of based in a property interest and property rights. And I guess it seems to me when the Founding Fathers talked about it, you know, they believed in the economic and utilitarian principles, but they believed that the property right was really what would drive economic benefits. So do you think that your report kind of moves us away from that historical understanding?
No, actually, I think that that our a recognition that that the utilitarian principle helps to define what the proper scope of a property right is as much a foundational principle of property law in the United States across the board. All different kinds of property have sort of limitations built into them, and I think that's been true for copyright. Copyright's gotten somewhat broader in certain respects, and it has evolved over time, but I don't think that it's not a property right. I do think that it's a utilitarian informed property right as it should be.
There was this article, I think it was in Politico, and it was a musician. He basically said that if some of what you were advocating was adopted, that you could have an individual just post a photo online, like a family photo or something that wasn't registered, and you could have a user just take that and use that for their commercial gain. So do you agree? Is that true?
No, I don't believe it's true at all.
And why not?
Well, because one of the things that we made very clear was that to the extent that someone is commercializing something that someone posts online, that that's actually an activity that that copyright law would apply to. I think that's very clear from our report, especially this, discussion about commercial harm.
Okay, well, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I thank the gentleman from Florida. The chair recognizes the distinguished gentleman from North Carolina, Mr. Watt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I want to thank all of the witnesses who have enlightened us. And I've gotten in the habit of waiting until last on our side to go because I always am fascinated by some of the questions they get asked and some of the answers. I'd have to say that the one that has fascinated me the most today is Ms. Samuelson's notion that we might be able to do this in 20 pages. Somebody in Europe apparently did this in 20 pages. And I'm kind of searching for a way forward here. I'm looking for either consensus on the 20-page notion or repudiation of the 20-page notion. Mr. Bumgarten, I think, wants to either affirm it or repudiate it.
Repudiate. I'm not one of those who beats the drum for simple solutions. The problems are too complex. I fear that a simple...
I got you. Actually, I like simple solutions. I mean, the great beauty of the Constitution and the amendments was simplicity, but the great beauty of the Community Reinvestment Act actually is simplicity in the statement you financial institutions should serve the community in which they live, right? The regulations that have been written to interpret that have gone into volumes now. The regulations, the court decisions to interpret the Constitution have gone into volumes now. Our problem here in Congress is that we either have to write a law that covers every eccentricity, every nuance, or we have to write a general principle and delegate responsibility for the nuances to regulators. Then we get accused of, you know, delegating to people who have not been elected. So we're kind of in a quandary here about how to move forward. If there's anybody on this panel who actually agrees that we could do this in 20 pages, I would love to have you take a shot at it. I'm not being facetious here because I would love to see a copyright law that is encompassed in 20 pages. But then the question I would raise is who would enforce it? Who would interpret the general principles? And how would you move forward without just massive litigation if it were the courts doing it? Or if you gave the authority, the Copyright Office doesn't have any enforcement authority now. It's a wonderful office, but it can't smack anybody upside the head and write a decision and say you can't do this under the principles that exist. So I'm in this quandary. I mean, should we be giving more enforcement authority to somebody? Should we have regulators? We got the FCC, they're kind of in their niche over there to do some of this. But Professor Samuelson, we got these simple principles. You say we got a built-in flexibility. That was your, I wrote that down when you said it. My question is, how do we do this with simple principles, flexibility, without some other enforcement mechanism other than ending all the parties up in massive litigation?
Well, I think much of copyright law that I admire, and we talk about that in the first part of the report, is basically very simple, simple principles that have proven to be.
But it took you 68 pages to write the article.
Well, yeah, but.
I did look at the article. There's 68 pages of the article that you wrote.
But I think actually only about 10 of them distill down.
So you want to take me up on my offer then?
I would
To give me 20 pages. I'm serious. I would.
Yes.
I think the committee would benefit from your conceptions on this panel of what the law should say and how we do this, build in principles, give it flexibility, and who would enforce it. That's my challenge.
Well, a lot of what causes copyright to be enforced now is the norms and practices of people who engage in this activity.
But one of the reasons we're updating it is people are less and less abiding by those norms, especially users who just think everything ought to be free, and they don't want to pay for anything.
Well, I don't know that that's always true. There's actually a study that called Copy Culture that suggests that a lot of people who engage in some sharing actually are bigger purchasers of content than other people. So I think that I care as much, I think, as anyone in this room for developing a law of copyright that can be more widely respected, and it seems to me the more comprehensible it is, the more it focuses on normative principles, the more likely it is to breed respect. And that's been a driving goal of mine in this project.
Mr. Chairman, I know I'm over my time, but I want to see if there's anybody else on the panel who wants to take me up on the 20-page challenge. Seriously.
Seriously, we'll work with Pam on it.
I'm certainly happy to work with you in the subcommittee. Can I say in 10 seconds why I think this 20-page version that Professor Samuelson was showing you is a great idea? Essentially, it recognizes this. There are some uses that are exclusive uses that should be exploited only by the copyright holder. There are uses that should be entirely free, like fair use in this country. And then there are uses in between that are subject to what we would call compulsory licensing, but they made them a special category, and they clearly explained why certain uses fit in all three. And I think it may not be, legislatively speaking, a model we can use in terms of language, but the idea sounds very good.
How long y'all think it'll take you to get me 20 pages? I'm not putting pressure on, I'm just trying to get a ballpark idea of when we might expect something. I know you got law school to teach, and especially in North Carolina, we want our lawyers down there to be taught well. So, I'll.
Gentleman's time's expired.
I'll yield back.
I want to echo what Mel said. I want to first of all thank the witnesses. You've been here for 3 hours. I want to also express thanks to those in the audience. I did not detect anyone had been induced to sleep. So maybe it's not as dull and boring as my journalistic friend concludes. This concludes today's hearing. Thanks to all for attending. Without objection, all members will have 5 legislative days to submit additional written questions for the witnesses on additional materials for the record. This hearing is adjourned.